So let's now generate the impulse response with the help of the DFT. So the impulse response of an FIR filter. And so this time we use the inverse discrete Fourier transform to generate this. So this means, because we're using the discrete one, that this is a numerical, that's a numerical approach. So no integration over complex numbers, but we just use the Python command for the inverse Fourier transform. Because remember, again, we can do the following. So imagine again, we would like to have a frequency response which looks like this. So h of k. So we would like to have a response like this, and this is here m half. And if this is just a discrete discrete spectrum, then we just do a IFFT, and then out there we are getting our impulse response. So the only thing what we need to have is a proper understanding of the inverse Fourier transform. So the coefficients of the IFFT, so that's the one which we're going to use. There are obviously different versions of this, but that's the one which is used in Python and in most other applications. So if we have here, that's our IFFT, and so these are our M frequency coefficients, then the output gives us again M filter coefficients. Yeah, so our h of n has again the length of m. Obviously, this one here needs to be complex, conjugate, or symmetrical. So that this one then here becomes a real sequence. So the question is now, so how are these coefficients actually ordered? There's something important to say about this here. So ordering of the coefficients. So on the frequency side here, we've got our x of k, and so if this is our x of k here and this is our index k, then this goes here to m minus 1, and then let's say if we have a bun stop response, we have something like that, and then in the middle we have m half, and so we know that m half the midpoint, that corresponds to fs half, so half of the sampling rate. Then the x of 0, that corresponds to 2dc. So if you want to manipulate the dc, and remember there is no mirror for 4dc, and then whatever coefficient we are manipulating here, let's say that is k, then the corresponding coefficient here is n minus k. So that's a bit tight here. So that's n minus k, and then this is here k. So that's a mapping here of this for the mirror. Then the other interesting thing is, so what is this in terms of frequencies, actually, that we also have this here. So this region here up to from 0 to m half, so these are positive frequencies. So if we're setting these coefficients to 1, then we're getting a positive frequency. And so what is with these mirrors here? So from m half plus 1 to m minus 1, these are negative frequencies. So this means, it's just basically that the complex pointer is rotating the other way around. And so that's for the frequency, or for the frequency coefficients here. And so how does it look like for the time? So now we've got our x of k here, and so now we do our inverse Fourier transform, and we're getting our small x of n here. And I call it small x of n, not h of n, because that's still not our impulse response. So if this goes here to m minus 1, and here we've got m half, and so that's our impulse response now. And so now if this is here our x of n, and we have done the inverse Fourier transform of this, then we see there's something really interesting happening here. And so therefore it will look like probably like that. And then this will here continue and will look like that. That's a bit too exaggerated here. So maybe something like this. So that's how x of n looks like. So now that's a bit odd. From the analytical point of view, remember when we did the analytics, we got an impulse response out there which looked like that, and then we shifted the whole thing into positive time. And now we see something like that here. So that looks a bit strange, isn't it? So now the reason this looks like this here is that this is here actually positive time, and this one is here negative time. So that's an N, negative time. And so essentially this one here, there's just the order wrong. So we could, if we just swap this over here to that side, then this looks already much more familiar. And so therefore if you're taking this here, And so we have this function here, and now we move this to that side here. And then this will look like that. So that's our negative time, and that's our positive time. But now as we know, we would like to have a causal system, so our coefficients not going to just to m half, but they're going to into m minus 1. And so therefore actually our where we would like to have our function is that we would like to shift it back into positive time. That we getting our coefficients. So now I just write here h of n, so that we are somewhere in the middle here. So it just goes like that. And so now we have here positive time shifted, and here we've got our negative time shifted. And so we see that if we are now shifting this over here, so if we comparing now our starting point here with our h of n, then we see here that essentially if we want to have these two shifted in time, that they're looking properly, we just essentially swap these two sides here. So if we look here, positive time goes to here and negative time goes to that side. So this means to come directly from xn to h of n. So we just swap these two parts. So now we can summarize this here. So using the inverse fast Fourier transform to design an FIR filter. So what we do is first we define our frequency response already in the DFT fashion. And there we've done already this essentially implicitly, that our negative frequency is sitting on the wrong side. So if this m half here, and we would like to create this frequency response, so it's here our example response, then what we do is we do a inverse fast Fourier transform, and with that we are getting our small x of n. It's an n, and then this will look probably something like that. And so then we have here again m minus 1, that's m half. And so now, as I said, to get this, to shift this actually in positive time, remember this was here positive time and that's negative time. So what we need to do is now we just need to swap these two axes here. So if this is here n, and now we call this here h of n, then what we need to do is, so we bring that over here and we bring that over here, and so then this looks something like that. That's here no longer visible. Okay, let's throw this here. So that's m minus 1, and so now we have here the midpoint of m half. So with that, by just swapping these two sides, we ordering our time properly and at the same time shifting it again in positive time. And then of course, plus window functions. To get the desired response.